Hey there, Killer Bees. I'm Pruitt, and this is Jim Davis. And an elderly, unkempt bard once said, "Oh, baby, I like it raw. Yeah, baby, I like it raw." But then again, that was a song, and this is a game. So let's get raw on WebDM. Oh, and I do have your money.
This episode is brought to you by the Dungeoncraft Kickstarter. Live now! Build your own battle maps in no time at all by using over 1,000 pieces of gorgeous terrain.
They're a cool-looking, easy-to-store, and affordable way to level up your combat. Each book consists of reversible pieces for building dungeons, cityscapes, and wilderness, along with all the creatures you need to run your game. They've even got companion books for battles on the high seas or in hell.
They sent us an early prototype, and they are useful as all get-out. So check it out. Link here and in the description.
Raw versus Rye.
Rye. Yeah.
Or to be Ray.
Yeah.
Half of Raiden.
Sure.
Anyway, it doesn't matter. So, rules as written versus rules as intended.
Yeah, and how they interact with homebrew and new DMs and just sort of learning the game and all that business.
Yeah, all of it's kind of wrapped up together. Like, well, but the heart of it is. Does it have to be raw?
For me, this line of thought I got going about a month ago, sort of mid-March. And it was a series of tweets from some people on D&D Twitter, as well as some other things that I'd, you know, just sort of absorbed. Basically along the lines of, like, new DMs do not deviate from the rules as written. This is sort of like the advice that I was picking up. The idea being that, you know, the rules are a complex thing and you could do something that would mess up your game. You have no idea how something's going to impact it.
You remove one moving part and the whole machine just wobbles itself apart like a washer that you threw a brick into.
Especially like, oh, don't homebrew, don't bring in homebrew stuff, don't tinker with the game, don't try to deviate, maybe reskin something, you know, but play the published adventures, play the starter set adventure. And it just was like, while I got the sort of like gist of a lot of this advice and where it was coming from and sort of like, you know, more like a learn to walk, learn to crawl before you can walk kind of advice. The way it was presented and sort of like mixed with sort of like the advice that we get asked about, particularly from new DMs, and a lot of like the pressure that they feel to have everything down, to have everything memorized and ready and internalized and perfect. This advice specifically that I kept seeing of like, play it as written, don't change things, do this, do that, contributes to a feeling of a pressure that new DMs might feel because this sort of like, you mean I have to do all this first? Like, how can I know what the rules as written are unless I read every page of these rule books before I even think about starting a game? I just don't necessarily agree with that perspective on it, and I certainly would never want to contribute to people thinking like they've got to do more to get into DMing, because like, people already feel intimidated by it as is.
The thing is D&D is a game. It's, you're not disarming a bomb.
Right.
You don't need to know every step of the process to have X outcome. It can be ad hoc. You can learn as you go. It's okay to clip a wrong wire in D&D.
A lot of the attitude of like, don't use homebrew things, especially if you're not like an expert on the game. Don't tinker with things. Don't change things around. Or if something's missing from the game, maybe it's missing for a reason. That kind of attitude. My gut says that it is born out of play experiences with total strangers who are not talking with each other or not committed to a certain style of play or a certain game. Their reactions to it seem to suggest to me bad play experiences that they are universalizing. Do not do this because it was a bad experience for me.
Yeah.
And given all of the bad experiences that are out there in gaming and RPGs, all of the just bad actors and people who are out to play with an axe to grind or some sort of grudge or...
I was going to say, Jim, I mean, we have played under a DM that played it pretty raw, and it was still...
incredibly antagonistic.
Incredibly antagonistic, and use that as a cudgel. Like, anytime you wanted to just kind of like, well, I mean, I have this idea that my character could do this, is like, no, you can't do that. Look right here on this page.
Yeah, this is very restrictive, and the rules are never going to fix the social problems at your game. They just won't. They never, you know, if you've got a problem with a player, you have a problem with a person. The rules are not going to fix that.
Yeah.
And so this sort of like idea that you have to stick to the rules as written, that they represent some kind of sacred text almost. I mean, that's kind of hyperbole on my part, but you shouldn't, because there's something that needs to be honored by sticking to the rules as written, that people poured all their heart and soul and the experience of the designers and playtesters and all this other stuff. And you're like, Yeah, maybe.
I think that they present you a good basis for everybody to start from, but it is okay to go ahead and talk with your group and step beyond that starting area, that starting place. Right. To what you said, I don't want to get on a big religious diversion, sure. But it does kind of run parallel. There are kind of interpretations to religious texts, and all of a sudden now you start having literal flame wars over how to interpret certain things.
Yeah.
Even when the rules are just written on the page, there are several interpretations of that. Sure. We say it all the time, but this is a game.
This is a game, yeah.
And it's okay to deviate.
Yes, definitely.
From the text, you bought this, yeah. Right?
It's worth asking, why are we even using rules to begin with? Like, what are the role of them? How do they shape the way that the game's played? I mean, the fact that it's a game is a consequence of there being rules. Otherwise, it would just be like, you know, freeform storytelling.
Freeform improv storytelling.
I play to play a game. And I like interfacing with game rules. I like manipulating them. I like tinkering with them. I like changing them. I like making them fit a particular play style that I've got, or to reflect certain attributes of the world that I'm in. All of that requires you to bend, break, tinker, add, remove, hack this thing apart. And I think it's both, number one, it's keeping with the tradition of D&D as a sort of do-it-yourself hobby. The role of like tinkering, of making minor adjustments to things is a time-honored tradition and one that seems to be pretty standard experience for new DMs, because you're going to eventually reach something where you're like, I need something else. It's not here, or I want to change this thing.
Yeah, there's a whole lot of stuff on DM's Guild. There's a whole lot of stuff on DriveThruRPG. There's a whole lot of stuff on Reddit and other forums, people presenting things like, hey, I got this new thing. I got this. Here's a bunch of new spells. Like, because there are creative people out in the world and they can be inspired by rules and to take that next step.
Yeah.
And by saying like, no, raw only, you are literally subjugating creativity.
Yeah.
For something that is an inspiration, a muse.
You would deviate because you want to tinker. You would deviate because you're inspired by something. You'd deviate because you want to make the game more your own, because maybe you've got players at the table who want something different out of the game that's not present. Maybe you see like weak spots or problem areas, a spell or an ability or something isn't working for you and not creating problems for your group. Then if you felt like, no, I can't change this because it's written in the book, and if I did that, I'd be, you know, breaking some kind of agreement with the game designers and the writers, or I'd be changing things about the game world or something that would undermine the players. And it's like, talk to the players, certainly, but the game designers might have a lot of experience, they might have a lot of ingenuity and creativity and inspiration, but they can't make things custom for your game table. They can't know what your game table needs. And they're very honest about this, right? Like, this is why adventures a lot of times are generic and have the kind of things in them that they have, because they need to provide a book that's useful for the widest audience possible. And they need to provide inspirational material for people who have no experience with this versus people who have decades of experience with it. And that means that they can't create stuff for your game that's custom, that speaks specifically to your table's needs. You're going to have to do that yourself. And you should feel free to do that, even if you're a brand new DM. Because, like Pruitt's saying, it's not a bomb that's going to go off. The worst that could happen is a yelling match between you and some people at the table, and hopefully it never comes to that. But if it does, like, you will hopefully be okay. It will be unpleasant. You will chalk it up to experience and modify your behavior after that, and you know, as you continue gaming. Hopefully it doesn't put you off gaming. But trying to avoid those bad experiences, trying to, like, and particularly trying to design a rule system that avoids those bad experiences, I do not think that that's a successful avenue.
Well, I'm sorry to say this, but even the rules as written spur so many arguments. How is that any different than you saying, I want to introduce this new thing,
right,
and it spurs an argument? Right. Like, okay, well, we're gonna argue anyway.
We might as well be having some...
It's arguing a direction towards progress.
Role-playing games can be very cost-effective. That the amount of money you might spend on a rule book versus the number of hours of enjoyment you're going to get out of it is pretty good. But not everybody can even afford a rule book. So if all you have is access to the free rule set, then you are by sort of like circumstance forced in a position where you're going to have to make things up for yourself or borrow them from places online. And again, you should not feel restricted to that. You should not feel like, oh, I have to buy these things in order to play this game that has a free rule set. I don't have the money. I don't, you know, if you're a student or you just don't have that kind of disposable income. You shouldn't feel like cut off from that. You should feel, unburdened to just create what you want. And the do-it-yourself D&D community out there is huge. They produce some amazing things. And some of them aren't right for your game, and some of them are. Just got to play to find out.
You got to go out there like a panhandler of old and sift for that gold in the silt and soot of homebrew content.
There's bad homebrew out there. And by bad, I mean it will deliver a play experience that you don't want.
There's some broke-ass stuff out there. There's some stuff that's a way too OP.
And you're only going to know if it is for your game if you try it. And if it doesn't work out, and if you try it in a spirit of like, hey, we're going to like maybe try this as a limited option or something, or this is a trial period. I think with all of these things, whether you're tinkering, whether you're homebrewing, whether you're using everything as it's written without any deviation, like you still got to talk to your players. Mm-hmm. You still have to find some common ground for what kind of game you want. None of that is trumped by, you know, just following the rules.
What it speaks to, Jim, and moving on to the next point, is whose game is this? Whether you paid for the player's handbook or you downloaded the free rules, once you take it to your table, isn't it your game?
I think the designers of Dungeons & Dragons are very honest about this. And if you read the Sage Advice Compendium, which if you're talking about like wanting to get deep in the weeds on rules, then read the Sage Advice Compendium. You know, I think it's quite fascinating. But it has a discussion, and this is a document that's sort of like updated by Jeremy Crawford. He's sort of the rules master of 5th edition, and this is a clarifying document for pervasive problems that they've come up with, as well as like their rulings on certain edge cases or just their commentary. It's not ironclad. It doesn't replace the DMG. It doesn't replace your DM's rulings or your DM's judgment. It's a supplement to it. But there's a discussion there about like what's the point of having rules in the first place? And what are the three ways that they see rules and that the Sage Advice team presents their commentary on the rules? And I think it's really interesting to read. If you are, you know, curious about game design, if you're curious about just making things that are in line with sort of the core assumptions of 5th edition, or you want to publish things for others to consume, because that's a different conversation. We're mostly talking about stuff you're making for the four or five people at your game table. Then you would want to read that because it's just got a lot of great stuff in it. The section on like what's the point of the rules is very clear. They were trying to design a game system that does not account for every possibility. That's what 3rd and 4th edition were attempts to do. 3rd edition is like, we're going to put a game stat for everything. There is a rule for everything. Everything is codified and part of this thing. And, you know, if you got a lot of free time and, you know, it's a priority for you, that can be an asset, but it can really bog down play.
And if you have the time to go through all the skills and find out all the synergies so you know exactly what skill points you wanted to put in 3rd edition, and trust me, I used to do that.
Yeah,
you can have a badass character, but that's something you want to do on your own time.
Or 4th edition, which seemed to want to create a game that that minimized the damage that adversarial DMs could do to the game. You know, it seemed like it was a game that was meant to remove as much of the deliberative and decision-making judgment calls out of the DM's hands as possible and just say, like, follow this formula. Here's how you present these things. And the choice for the DM was in, like, individual combats and how to approach that and how to structure the campaign overall, but less judgment calls. 5th edition is a hard 180 on that. And it's rulings, not rules. It's a flexible, robust rule set designed to give you tools. And if you check out our ability score and action resolution episode, we kind of touch on that. It's there to give you a building block so that in this situation right now, as it happens at the table, you have the rules that you need to make a call. You can consult with the player's handbook, DMG. You can consult with supplementary material. Hopefully you enjoy the videos that we produce and they are of use to you. Ultimately, it's your call. If you don't have the time to read through a rule book, you don't read in a way that's like cover to cover, you do sort of more patchwork, read the sections that you need to as you need them, revisit them as you needed, then that's perfectly fine. You can have a very successful, enjoyable, fulfilling game with idiosyncratic understanding of the rules that's unique to your table. Don't put that kind of pressure on yourself. That's a digression about the Sage Advice Compendium. Check it out because it has some really interesting stuff that's like related to this. Have you ever read it? Have you ever checked it out or anything?
Oh, yes. Oh, no. I like to go through Sage Advice all the time. I find it very interesting because that's where you can really see, like, you or I might read a rule. And I mean, hell, I come to you all the time and I'm like, hey, how do you read this? Like, what's your read on this? Because I think it's this. And you're like, no, it's this. What it does is you get to see other people's perception or interpretation of that rule. And then you see the main man himself of the rules, Jeremy Crawford, giving you like, no, this is what was intended. He handles them so well. Because a lot of times what he says is basically what we're saying here is just do what's right for your table. This is your game. Hell, when we interviewed him, he basically said the exact same thing.
Yeah.
And it's your game. I don't know what you wanted.
Yeah. First page of that compendium basically says this is a tool set for the Dungeon Master to build upon, implying that change and addition and making it your own is the intent of the designers of 5th edition. And therefore, there's no need to be like, no, I have to stick to this as written, because the point of this is to create something unique for yourself. This isn't to say you don't need to read the rules. This isn't to say they aren't there to facilitate a game. Obviously they are. It's just to say that you don't need to understand them inside and out to have internalized them, to be able to just like rattle off a ruling without needing to look something up, without needing to pause the game. That's just a skill you're gonna have to learn. And if you wanna learn the rules as written, then you're gonna have to read the rule books. You know, I mean, that's not a controversial statement.
Yeah,
at all.
Definitely. But you know, all that experience and everything that goes into making these games, though, I think it is a good foundation to build off of. Like you said, it is there to give you something to create an equivalent of or an alteration of, so that you're not breaking the game, so that you have something to work off of.
The role of the DM is to facilitate the game, to make rulings, to present situations for the players to overcome, to play the adversaries that they face, and to play the rest of the world as it reacts to the player's actions. And in that sense, the Dungeon Master is going to need to make judgment calls. They're going to need to make rulings. They're going to need to change things. And in the grand tradition of D&D, a long-running D&D campaign very often has an evolving rule set, a supplementary house rule document or something that changes the way things happen, because it might be like 15 sessions in, you guys are like, gosh, we really hate the way this one thing works. I hate initiative that's rolled. It stops combat. It breaks up the tension. I really hate calling for initiative, having to track it, having to do whatever. So I just borrowed Shadow the Demon Lord initiative for when I run 5th edition. Who's doing one thing? Anybody doing one thing? All right, you go first. Anybody doing more than one thing? You're going to go second. Monsters always go second to players, and it's just boom, 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 fast. And when the edge cases, because we're not using the D&D version of initiative, come up, we just make a ruling in that spot. There's no one size fits all to it. It's just what makes sense in this moment. I can do that because I have the experience of DMing. I have players that trust me. You will get there as well. You just got to play the game and keep doing it.
When it comes to that, though, how many times do people take fast versus slow actions?
Very rarely is it fast, and we have modified it so that dashing is a fast, because people were like, oh, I'm dashing. It didn't make sense that you would go after someone else, because all you're doing is like moving really quickly. So we sort of said like a dash or a double dash something is still a fast action. It benefits spellcasters a lot, because a lot of times the spellcasters are just doing one thing. They're just casting one spell, whereas the fighter types are doing two things. They're making two attacks, or they're moving and attacking, something like that. I find that if someone's just casting a spell, then they'll do fast. But most often, it's like, anybody doing a fast action? Crickets. And then it's, okay, you guys go. Combats are much faster. They're more fluid. There's no break between that moment of pre-combat than combat. They just roll right into it. But it's rough around the edges. You got to make rulings. So it's an example of how your game will evolve and the rules that you use for it will evolve if you want them to. They don't have to, but it is kind of a tradition to mold the game as it goes on to your needs. And I think like that is within the intent of the designers. Like, I think they want you to do that.
We kind of touched on in the introduction of this episode that sometimes even raw has problems. Would you like to expand on that?
First off, let's talk about like what actually raw is. It refers to rules as written. And in the specific context of 5th edition D&D, it is used by the D&D team to describe a perspective that they adopt when they are making rulings about Dungeons and Dragons, specifically Jeremy Crawford. So it says in the compendium, like, listen, I want to be able to see the text as you see it. You are not the game designer. You do not know what we intended when we wrote this thing. Oftentimes what you write does not get read the way you intended to write it, or that you intended. And so they want to try as much as possible to see the rules as we see them, which is just text, nothing else. And therefore, they adopt this perspective and will rule from make rulings from this perspective, or clarifications from this perspective, because they're trying to be as close to your perspective as possible. That's what the rules as written intend. There's rules as intended, which is RAI, and that is, what did the game designer intend to do? What is the purpose of this rule? Why was it written? Insight into that might help a dungeon master make a ruling. You might say, oh, okay, well, I mean, this thing is there not to be punitive to the players or something, but to facilitate a different kind of conflict. And it might seem punitive from the player's perspective, but in actuality, it's there to, like, provide tension and something like that. An example of that might be, say, concentration. From a player perspective, it's very limiting. You can't cast all the spells you want.
You can't be invisible and fly.
Yeah, not with spells.
No. And have displacement up and have dark vision. Yeah.
It's there to help you understand what they intended because it will help you make a ruling. And so if you know that the reason why, say, concentration is there is to limit the power of spellcasters and have it be that they don't overshadow the rest of the party using their magic, then you are better able to say, like, oh yeah, well, we're not gonna mess with that right now. I like the way it works. Or we are gonna mess with it because I do want casters to be really powerful. And the final way that they do is like rules is fun, which is just like, you know, the rules should facilitate an enjoyable experience.
Yeah, the rule of cool.
Those are the three perspectives that they kind of adopt and that they think are a good mix of those is what makes for a successful game. Like the point of all of this is for me is to like lower the stakes to getting into DMing. I know that a lot of new DMs out there feel like they've got to do a lot of things, that they've got to have it perfect. It's got to be down pat. They can't make a mistake. They can't get something wrong. Or if they do get something wrong, it'll be like a disaster or something. And I understand that pressure. I understand that, you know, that need to get it right. I still feel it before every game. I still get a little bit of like, oh crap, I am not prepared for this. I could have done X, Y, Z. I could have had this ready. I could have done that. That doesn't go away. Just your ability to be like, it doesn't matter. We'll get better.
Yeah.
I will say this. If you want to understand the game inside and out, if you want to be a master of this, then you should probably run the game a couple of times without changing anything. That's what I did, right? We played out the Rise of Tiamat game. I was like, guys, no house rules, yeah. No option. I mean, even though we did, we used feats. We used the flanking advantage. You know, I mean, we used those. And honestly, this speaks sort of my experience. We used a house rule my first time running 5th edition. And I thought like, oh yeah, advantage on flanking. What's the big deal? It was only after playing through the full campaign, and I didn't change it in the middle of it. It didn't break the game. But I noticed like, hey, there are all these abilities, all of these spells, all these other things that are not getting used because all it takes is two players moving on the other side of a monster, getting advantage, and hacking it to pieces. That means that there's all these things that they could be using, these class abilities, these spells, these magic items, that they're not. Therefore, they're not worth using, they're not worth taking, they're not worth giving out. That cuts out a huge portion of the game by the inclusion of this one house rule. And so when I ran the next campaign, I was just like, hey, we're not going to use that one again. If I did it again, I might do something different. Maybe not advantage, maybe some other thing that you would get from flanking.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't say that to undermine the whole point of the video, only to say that the attitude isn't wrong. If you want to know the game inside and out, you should run the game using the rules as close to they are written as possible. But, and this is a huge badonkus of a but.
And you cannot lie.
Gigantic one. It is not necessary to running a successful campaign. It is not necessary to running a satisfying game for your friends, to starting DMing. You need to know something. You need to know about ability scores. You need to know which dice to roll. You need to kind of have an idea of what they're going to do. But learning by doing and learning by experimentation is a great way to learn the game. And if you really want to learn it inside and out, start from a perspective of these are the rules as written. We will begin here. But understand that you might need to change things. That's perfectly fine. Relax. Take a deep breath. Mm-hmm. You're going to be fine. And when you're ready, it's time to just try a one-shot. Try a little bit. Dip your toe in. See what method works for you. And don't feel like you've got to absorb 3 of these books and plus the adventure and know everything that's going to happen, plus all the player stuff. Don't put that kind of pressure on yourself.
Yeah, in order to have any kind of authority on the matter.
Yeah, right.
It's like, well, you're the DM.
Yes.
That gives you the authority.
We talk all the time about how this little obscure rule is in here and it's probably ignored because people don't read that section. But again, not necessary to facilitate a game, have a great experience. You will learn by doing and by trying something, it not working and having to make it fit, than like always sticking to the way it's presented in the rules. It's just not necessary.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more.
Want to see us play? We've got games every week on Twitch, which we upload to our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
If you like the video, hit that subscribe button, click the bell, give us a thumbs up, and tell us in the comments.
Thanks for watching.
but they've been standing there for like 10 minutes. Nope, sorry.
Sorry, oh. I love your channel.
Oh, thank you very much.
So nice meeting you. Dale.
Yes, you have your own channel,
I
yes?
do have my own channel.
There you go, yeah. I haven't seen a lot of videos of it, but I do follow
it's
it.
It's very weird being recognized by the web. That feels hey, a little wrong almost.
It feels
I'm
weird
so
to
you. I'm so new in the game. You guys are like legends.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate
well,
it.
Well, thank you for all the great videos.
Thank you. Thank you.
So great to see you.
Yeah, you too. Likewise.
Have a great weekend.
She has her own YouTube channel where she does like deep lore dives and stuff and like pulls from history and folklore. I freaking Dale, D-A-E-L.
This is the problem with your host. Co-host being ADD is I don't remember shit ever. I don't remember. People get bothered as they get older about how much they can't remember. I've never been able to remember anything. Names, faces, they come to me like bubbles out of my subconscious. So yeah, I'm never prepared for anything. Never.